What I wanted to touch upon next was considering that just the engineering career and the industry as a whole is a very volatile thing, constantly changing. I definitely think that it holds true a little bit that that it's not the most intelligent necessarily or the strongest that survive, but the ones that are most adept to change. I wanted to ask, considering how so many things have changed throughout your career, were there any other days that were there any days that were harder than others? I mean, were you ever at a point where you questioned your career choices?
Of course, yes. It's a very challenging field. It's there's a lot of challenges, and we have to adapt constantly. And I always say you got to get used to rejection, because you'll have a lot of that. So as long as you know from the get-go, okay, rejection, I can take it two ways. I can be like, oh, fuck you, or you can or put the tail between your legs and run, or you can take it as constructive criticism, which is you put a positive twist on something that's negative. That's the way I approach it. So when I have the bad days, I'm like, I want to learn from the bad days again to, you know, when they say experience and being wiser is learning how you've adapted to those bad mixes or bad days or crappy songs that sometimes we get. So those days actually help you. So again, the theme, turn a negative into a positive, okay? Because you're going to have a lot of negatives. You're going to have a lot of, you're going to hit a lot of brick walls. And I always say this really corny analogy that whatever it takes to get over that wall, whether you go to Home Depot and buy a shovel, whether you go and get a pole, when you go a jack, it doesn't matter. Point is you got to get over that wall. And you have to be willing to fight to get over that. So you are going to have moments where you're going to feel like, I hate the song. I hate this guy's guts. He's so talentless. I'm way more talented. You're going to have those days. But you got to remember, my high school mentor always said, hey, never forget what you were hired to do. Simple. If you remember that, man, you'll get so far. Because if I'm mixing a song and I'm with Kanye and I tell him his production sucks, it's not my job. Or I tell him I don't like the song. My job is not, hey, let's hire Manny to give us his opinion on the song. My job is to mix the shit out of that record. And that's it. I'm not going to give him production notes. I'm not going to tell him anything unless he asks me and I genuinely think he wants to know my honest opinion. And so that now the people skills kick in. You know, I think that after you guys graduate, if you go get a psychology degree, it'll help you as much as something like this, because you do have to read people's mind. You got to read their body language. You got to know if they had a bad day, if they had a fight with a girlfriend or wife or boyfriend or whatever. You got to kind of know what mindset they're at that moment. And that's when it becomes difficult for a lot of people. It's art. And the art of dealing with people is probably more than the skills you have as an engineer, mixer, producer, artist. So you got to be able to have those people skills. And again, the thing that this stuff that you guys already know, my advice is now you have to apply it. If you've made the commitment to come to a school like this, this is part of that curriculum. You got to work on stuff like that. And if you're a nice guy already, then hey, be a nicer guy. It won't hurt you. So.
Reflecting on your early career and developing all of your people skills, both technically and just in general, dealing with a variety of clients and being a mix engineer, you're right in the middle of that record making process where you're one of the key elements in creating a finished product. I wanted to ask, how do you deal with all of the varying opinions and varying needs of all the different parties involved? Whether it be producers or artists or what have you. How do you kind of make that compromise and manage that?
That's an excellent question. Have you guys heard of a group called Group Love? Anybody? It's a really cool band. Raise your hand if you have. Actually, their album is about to drop in the next 3 weeks. Really cool band. When I was mixing their album, I mixed half of it. They all showed up, all five of them. And the A&R showed up, and their manager. I had like seven people. in my tiny room, and they all had an opinion. Everybody has an opinion. You ask one thing, movie, the entertainment, mostly movies and music, right? Everybody has an opinion. I mean, from the janitor to the CEO of Google, everybody has an opinion. So part of my job as a mixer, I have to take all that information and I have to process it. And somewhere in there, I gotta know how far I have to entertain, because they're the clients. I have to entertain everything, but at the same time, I have to make sure that they're not hurting whatever the song is to my taste. And that's where it becomes really delicate, because I'm hired to mix the song. I'm not gonna tell him his bass part is off, or that's not my job. So when the bass player goes, hey, my bass, I feel is not punchy enough, loud enough, crunchy, whatever that is. And the singer goes, no, I think it's too crunchy or too punchy. So that right there alone, they have to make that decision. But now it's my job that if within X amount of time, and I give them 2 minutes, if in 2 minutes they can't come up with a compromise, and I step in, I say, why don't we try this? Listen to this. Is that what you're talking about? Yeah, that's more punch. No, but that's not what I want. Okay, well, what if we do this? Now the delegate, you know, you got to be a good delegator. And you're like, well, what if we try this? Now they're engaged in the song again. And again, everybody's got that ego where the bass player at some point thought his bass part was important and the singer didn't for that particular sound. Now my job is to get them engaged with the track again. Now they're listening again. Now maybe the ego again got in the way from the bass player, and he realizes when I soloed it and then unsoloed it, he goes, oh shit, no, it is there. Now I can hear it. Boom. So the psychology of that kicks in. Sometimes there's no resolution. When that happens, if I'll do two versions of it. You want one like this, and this is the other one. Live with it. I guarantee if you live with it for a day or two, you're gonna come back, you're gonna talk, and you're gonna pick one version, and it's done. So you try to simplify everything. They're there for you to make them feel comfortable as well. So your job is to, if there's any friction, and there's going to be, this is a create, there's no right or wrong. I'm not better than you. The singer's not better than the drummer. It's a compromise, and how do we get there? And that's why they hire mixers still. Everybody can mix a record. I mean, you guys are all mixers and producers. I mean, but I feel like they come to someone like me to kind of give them a little more of a taste. Like, hey, would you do it like this? And my job is to, yeah, I see where you're going, but what if you do this, and that? And they'll be like, oh shit, that's exactly what I was hearing in my head. I just couldn't execute it. And that's what we're there for. Sometimes some songs need more love than others. Some producers are great sonic producers that when you come in, stuff sounds incredible. So, and you're like, what am I gonna do to it? Once you get in the song, you're like, oh, this is the type of song that would, and 20 things come to mind, and you execute them, whether it's dynamics, color, filter, you know, 100 things can come into play. So your job as a mixer is to kind of put it all together and give you a little bit of what my taste would be. Like, if I'm working on a Rolling Stones song, how would I like the Stones to sound in 2013? I mean, they could get 20 other mixers, but they said, oh, let's see what maybe Manny can do. Maybe he can bring an element of this or that. And the way I approach it is, how would I like to hear? I would like to hear the Stones like this. Charlie needs some major cojones. Let's give him a little more kick drum. Let's round out the kick, and it's not pretentious or not too young or not too aggressive, but yet big and bold, and all these words come into play. How do we get that with frequencies? Oh, you add this, you take away that. Balance-wise, the snare needs to be thicker to match the kick, and you know, and then you go on and on and on and on.
Now, to go back in time and reflect a little bit, I wanted to ask you, do you remember the first time, your first break in the studio, like your first opportunity that really, really came to you besides, you know, maybe just helping out as far as like coffee or food or things like that, that first kind of break that happened for you?
You know, it's the classic story where I was, you know, we were all overtired working on the project, and the engineer would couldn't handle it anymore, and he goes home, and I was the assistant, and goes, can you take over? I'm like, hell yeah. And then the client goes, hey, man, can you do a rough mix? Hell yeah. 6 a.m, I play in the rough mix. I wake him up, and he listens to it and goes, picks up the phone and calls his partner in New York. It's like, yo, I just found someone that's going to mix the album. And I'm like, what? I was like 19 years old or 20. And that I remember being a break. By the way, that album never got released. It got shelved. But it gave me the confidence to be like, oh, maybe I do belong here. You know, it gave me that confidence. And then I pursued it. I did a lot of foreign records, like a lot of Japanese and Taiwanese records earlier, which was great because none of my friends heard them, so I could fuck up as much as I, and no one would judge me on it. It's like, yo, that kick on that song, man. So it was great, and I did it for a couple years, and that was really good training. And then, you know, my career never went like that. And I'm so happy for that, because I pay my dues, man. I just work my ass off. I always said one mix at a time, and I was always very under the radar. I never wanted to be that guy that was, hey, check me out. I just wanted to do good work, man, good quality work. And people eventually find out. People will be like, oh, yeah, oh, Manny mixed that. Oh, cool, let's try it. And just, you know, it just got bigger and bigger. But it was just, again, based on just being passionate about it and trying to be the best at it, you know, in a very humble way. You know?
Yeah, that's a great attitude to take. Now that you are where you are, you know, and your career has progressed, I kind of wanted to just get some perspective on what's a typical work day for you, not when you wake up in this?
I wake up at 8 in the morning, go to the studio and stay till 8 in the morning. No, 24 hours. You know, I go in the studio around 1 or 2, and I stay till, you know, 1, 2 in the morning, sometimes 5, 6 in the morning. There's really no, whenever I get tired, deadlines, of course, that, you know, if I have a deadline, like, then I gotta finish it. But if it's a typical day, I just work until I don't feel inspired anymore. And then that's when I know I'm either too tired or bored and I need to go home and get some rest. You know, your social life is not, you know, it's not gonna be the best. My wife is somewhere out there, but she's probably like, yep. But hey, listen, you take the good with the bad, and I wouldn't change it for anything in the world. I mean, I get paid to do what I love to do. I mean, how many people can say that? I read something that it's less than 1% of the population actually enjoys what they do. I mean, hey, I'll take that. You know, I'll take the long hours. I'll take the 3-hour sleep days to be able to do what I truly, not like, love to do. I just still can't believe people pay me. Someday I feel like they're gonna walk in and be like, all right, time's up. I'll be, all right, cool. 20 years later, all right, you got me. So, yeah. So it's definitely worth the sacrifice, for sure, at least for me. It may not be for everybody, but for me, it's worth every sacrifice.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, if you're doing something that makes you happy, I mean, everything else really is.
Nothing, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So, being in the position that you're in now, you know, so being so successful and active in the industry, for the students, I wanted to ask, what are some of the skills that you think that every aspiring engineer should possess or should work towards acquiring? You know, whether that be something technical,
this
like
this guy's got some really good questions. Wow.
Thank you.
First, you got to find good hair product. That's number one. You gotta, like I said earlier, you have to have knowledge of music and instrumentation and arrangement and all that. Like I said, if you don't play an instrument, go learn how to play basic chords on the piano, guitar, doesn't matter. That gets you engaged in listening to music in a different way. So you must possess that first and foremost, whether you're doing engineering, mixing, production, doesn't matter. Go learn an instrument. And the other thing is listening skills. You gotta listen to as much music. Listen to music all day long. Now with Spotify and all this stuff, it's I think music is at its best, and you know, for, at least for me, I'm more excited about music today than I've ever been because it's so accessible. I mean, I can get up and go to Sonos and play anything I want anywhere. So listen. Do not discriminate, like I said earlier. Learn an instrument. And now you're going to begin the technical process. Now you're going to be like, well, I love this song. How did they get that bass sound? Now you're here. Now you're going to maybe ask one of your instructors, hey, how would you get that bass sound? Oh, easy. You do this. You overdrive the preamp and you do this. You show that. Oh, okay. Cool. So now you're going to learn all these technical skills. But before you do that, you wouldn't have asked that question if you didn't, if you weren't passionate about some of the music. So again, the most simple one is appreciate and admire and don't discriminate music. That would be the first one. And then, you know, the others will just kind of follow. You're doing it now. You're at a great school. You're learning the technical side of it, which is obviously necessary, but it's just a tool that you must have. The other is the dedication and the desire and the passion. So there's a great book called Drawing from the Right Side of the Brain. And it's just that, it's about drawing. But what happens is, and I've said this a million times, we live in a left brain society, meaning the way you brush your teeth, tie your shoelaces, the way we drive, everything is left brain, right? The technical side. And they say that the right side doesn't really get tapped into. So what I did to become a better mixer is I started drawing, because I felt like how artists, like visual artists, they have to tap into the right side of the brain. They have to. They have no choice. But they also have their tools, and that's the left side. This is how you mix these colors. This is your brush. What type of brush? What is it? A canvas? Wood? What? All of that. But I took drawing lessons to be able to tap into the right side of the brain. So there's a great book. You don't have to do all the exercises on it, but it'll teach you how to subconsciously and consciously tap into the right side. Have you guys ever, this is a test for you, an experiment for you guys. Listen to a song with the lights like super bright, like these lights right here. And then listen to the same song and turn all the lights off and just sort of analyze how it makes, what the emotional difference is. And you're gonna notice it. And then start analyzing that. Start like putting it into your brain. Store it in your brain. Oh, it made me feel this way. Same thing with the right side of the brain. That's what the right side of the brain kicked in. It wasn't distracted by whether it's light or other things. So your right side subconsciously kicked in. So you listen to it from a different perspective. And that's our job. We need to make sure we listen to it from a technical side and a creative side. And it's gotta be equal. I can't be too technical because then I'm not as creative. And I can't be all creative and not technical because all my meters will be in red and the mastering engineer is gonna curse me out. So you gotta, you know, really try to read about stuff like that and how to tap into that right side of the brain.
So touching on you know, qualities that you like seeing as far as open-mindedness and things that you prioritize and think are important, you know, using both the right side and the left side of the brain in looking at something both technically and creatively. I wanted to ask, what qualities do you like to see in an intern or in the employees that you work with? Like, what are things that you like to see out of those individuals on a regular basis?
No tattoos, guys. Don't like tattoos, so I'm kidding. you know, again, personality. Just, I want to be in the room with someone that I can joke around and fuck around with, go get a beer or have sushi, but at the same time be able to work with me, because I work, man. I put it in. I don't take any shortcuts. I'm working harder again now than ever. So I'm a workaholic, and I need someone that can keep up with me. Someone that's sharp too. Someone that wants to learn. Someone that, if they can't remember it, write it down, because you know, we may say, call so-and-so and so-and-so, and if you think you can remember all that, great, but 99% of the people can't hold that type of information all the time. So the moment you forget, that's the moment you'll fuck up. So write everything down. So I look for someone that's has great personality, first and foremost. You can know everything about tools and all the shortcuts that I don't really care for, but I have to learn sometimes. You may know all those, and I can care less. I mean, if your attitude is just not cool, then my clients are gonna notice. I want my team to be a reflection, an extension of me. So, hey, I'm just an easygoing guy, so I don't want anybody in there that when an artist, a John Mayer, walks in, I want him to be as comfortable with them as he is with me. So, first and foremost, it's got to be your attitude. And then if you know all those really cool shortcuts, then that's a plus.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, I would absolutely agree. I mean, you can teach someone Pro Tools, but not necessarily how to be a good person, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And I think schools like this help, you know? Schools like this should, you know, and I'm sure they do teach you studio etiquette. Studio etiquette is, man, you'll get fired so fast if you don't have it. Your career will last 20 seconds. So that's why you're here, to learn what qualities you need to possess to be successful. And you could do pose too. It doesn't matter. We could do from John Mayer to pose to Foley. It doesn't matter. Just a good attitude, a thank you, and a please. Again, we'll get you far.
And touching on qualities that you think are really important for anyone to possess, just in this industry. Something else that I wanted to touch upon a little bit was whether you're a student juggling sessions and homework and studying and all of the various things that happen in our lives, or whether you're 20, 30, 40, 50 years into the industry. I think time management is something that everyone has to deal with. So I wanted to ask you, how do you approach time management? I mean, being so in demand and just such a busy guy in general, how do you manage all of your time, and how do you kind of deal with that?
He's good. Fuck. Again. I've done a lot of these, and this guy asked some of the best questions. I'll tell you, that's really good, because I do, I set my alarm, my iPhone alarm. So last week I had 3 rooms going, which I don't recommend, but I had to for deadlines. So I will set my alarm. I'll be in John Mayer world, because we were finishing the album this Sunday. So I'm in his world right now. And I set my alarm for an hour. And I say, this hour is gonna be quality time. This guy named Babyface, have you guys heard of Babyface, the artist? Yeah. He's the one that gave me the best piece of advice. I'm like, how do you deal? You got Russell Simmons, you got Puffy, you got all these people calling you. President Clinton, everyone's calling him, right? He had won back-to-back Producer of the Year at the Grammys. He had done the Clapton song, Heal the World, is that what it is? Yeah. Anyway, he was at the top of his game, and I was working, I was engineering for him at the time, and I just couldn't understand how he was doing multitasking. And I asked him the same question. And he said, it's all about quality time. He's like, if I'm a producer for 10 minutes, an hour, 6 hours, I'm gonna be the best producer. If I'm gonna be a husband for 1 hour, I'm gonna be the best. If I'm gonna be a father for, so understanding quality time. So it really stuck, and I'm like, oh shit, that's how you do it, okay. So I try to apply that. So if I said last week from 2 to 3 o'clock, it's John Mayer, and I'm gonna give it 100% John Mayer. Because from 2 to 3, at 3 o'clock, I'm gonna go to the other room and I'm doing John Legend. And it's gonna be from 2 to, so I set my timer. That's the only way I can do it, because if I get lost in John Mayer, it's easy to be creative and all of a sudden it's 8 o'clock and you got another couple sessions. So that works for me. I just set simple timer, and I set, I'm just gonna allocate this time. And I've learned over the years how to take advantage of that hour, consciously, very, very effective hour, than I would have maybe 10 years ago. It would have taken me maybe 6 hours to get what I can do now in one. So that's how I, it's funny you ask that, because I do that's a key, because you have all these deadlines and you got all these projects and you got to deliver on time. So the iPhone is really handy.
Oh yeah, I can definitely imagine. I mean, I'll tell you right now, if I was mixing a John Mayer tune, I'd definitely lose track of time for sure. So.
Oh yeah, and you know, whether you're a fan or not, it's good stuff. I mean, he's a really, really incredible artist, and seeing him work, it's one of those, you know, one of those projects I really look forward to.
Definitely. He's one of my personal favorites. So I wanted to shift gears a little bit. And so now that we've reflected and talked a little bit about, you know, the progression of your career and some of the attributes and things that you think are important, I wanted to dive in a little bit more onto what you do specifically, like as a mix engineer. It's rare that we have someone of a mix engineer of your caliber here visiting the school. So I kind of wanted to dive in a little bit more and maybe get some perspectives on how you view things just as a mixer. And I wanted to start off the section by asking, what's your philosophy on dynamics in a mix? I mean, considering especially the clientele that you're working with, radio play is a very serious consideration that you constantly have to be thinking of. And I think everyone in here to some degree is familiar with the whole loudness wars debate that's you know, constantly pervasive and happening today. So I wanted to ask, what's your approach on dynamics in a mix, and does it change based on the material that's in front of you?
Well, great point again. Because I do a lot of pop records as well. I'll do like from Justin Bieber to like Flo Rida and Enrique, and do a lot of that stuff. But then I also do some alternative like Linkin Park and Imagine Dragons and Fun. And then I'll do folky stuff, maybe like a John Mayer or the Dixie Chicks have the Courtyard Hounds, and maybe some, not that it would be, but I, you know, so genres have a lot to do with that. So let's just stick with one. We'll say pop, just because radio and the loudness and all that. My number one priority in a mix is always dynamics. That's it. So that's the first thing that I do. And drums, I'm a drummer, so I always gotta have, whether, I always start with drums, even if there's no drums in the song. You know? So rhythm section has to be tight, has to be important. Doesn't matter what genre you're in. But if we're doing pop, the loudness war, what's happening is, now we're going to get a little technical here. What happens is that the louder you get, there's a perception of the loudness perception. Sometimes it actually has a negative effect on dynamics. Well, not sometimes, all the time. So you have to be really careful. So the louder isn't necessarily better for the emotion. So again, dynamics for me is about emotion. Every mix that I do, I focus 100% on emotion. I'm an emotional guy. So whether I want to ride this roller coaster, this 3-minute roller coaster. So if it's if I'm in the verse, I'm aware where I'm at every single time I'm listening to it. Now, if I'm at a chorus, then I know it's in. I know if I'm in the first, second, or vamp, because I know what to play with. I know my sections. Arrangement, pop music, super, super important. You know that the intro is gonna go here to there to there to, you know, you can visualize the lines. But if I've hit this is my ceiling, and I can't go any louder than this, then what I do is I go to the point in the song that I feel should be the loudest. It could be the second chorus. Most of the time would be the chorus after the bridge or a rap, which is the outro or the vamp. So I start with that section. I'll start with that section and I'll make it as loud as possible. And then I work backwards. So then the section before that, I can't be as loud as that, or there's no emotional, you know, shift. Now, how can we do that? Well, simple enough, you bring the volume down. But when you bring volume down, then the energy goes down. So now you got to make decisions. Do I want my energy to stay like this if it's one of those tracks, or do I want it to go this, or do I want it to do that? And that's when you make the decision. Do I use volume? Do I use compression? Do I use EQ? Do I use filters? I do a lot of filtering, low and high passing. Not as an effect, but as an emotional transition, meaning that if I want my verse to be softer than my chorus, I will filter some of the stuff within the track, and I will automate the filter, but you won't know that. When you listen to it, when the chorus pops, you're like, oh shit, here it is. But the level will maybe be the same, but the emotion will be different. Now, you can achieve this with, you know, processing some of the frequencies out, you know? So that's why I play a lot with low pass and the high pass filters, a lot of EQing, and that's when it gets exciting, when you start playing with colors and to achieve emotion. Again, it's like why I fell in love with this. So there's different techniques that you can achieve without necessarily always being like this. Now, what happens to a loud mix? There's a fatigueness that happens. So you gotta be really careful that when your mix is so loud and so hyped but it's one of the greatest songs written, but it doesn't become a hit if we're in the pop world. It doesn't get played as much on the radio or doesn't really chart that well. Well, what happens is it's your job to not make it so fatiguing, because we've learned that when I listen to a song and I feel the 3 minutes, I feel really stressed and I'm like, fuck, I need some water or something. It's like, I'm stressed out just listening to this incredible song, by the way, but I don't know if I can listen to that again. Now you've really fucked up, because the song it didn't reach its potential. So it's our job to make sure that if it is a loud song, that you, again, you mind fuck the listeners. And this is where So, and that's kind of my job. I'm trying to mind fuck people into thinking that this section is lower, but really isn't. It's lower in frequencies and compression and sometimes volume. Simple as half a dB or a dB make a huge difference. But I don't want you to know that. I mean, of course, you guys, because you guys are here for that. But I don't want the listener to be aware of, like, whoa, where did that come from? Why is that so loud all of a sudden? So there's different techniques that we all use for that perceived loudness. It can't be, if this is my ceiling, my mix cannot start here and end there, because you just killed the song. I mean, the song is done. You will never be able to get it back. So that's the thing that, you know, when you next time you listen, Music Appreciation Day today, when you listen to something else, listen to the perceived loudness, dynamics, and why does it sound louder? What instrument makes it sound a certain way? Why is it that that guitar and the vamp jumps out and my body kind of changes, you know, my body language, kind of my shoulders raise a little. Why is it that that guitar, why is that tone? Oh, got it. When I listen to a song, I didn't mix It's Time by Imagine Dragons, but I love that song. They played it for me and I thought it was a smash the first time I heard it. But there's a guitar in the vamp that comes in. And I remember thinking, and listen, this is just last year. I mean, you think I would know this by now. But I appreciated the fact that this guitar came in the vamp. If you analyze that song, that guitar makes the song, in my opinion. That is the moment that every time I listen to the song, I can't wait to get to that moment. Now, again, I don't know who mixed that, but whoever did that, it's a part of production / mixing. They got me. They're mind fucking me into thinking that I can't wait for this section of the song. So the next song I mix, I naturally added a bunch of mids to a guitar in that section. And not that it worked, but it inspired me to work on dynamics. I mean, I can go on for another 3 hours talking about dynamics, but that's basically, you know, in a nutshell, that's what you guys have to be aware of.
And talking about dynamics, perception of dynamics, and how there's a variety of techniques, both in your end of things, and also the musical arrangement, you know, the different instrumentation that's happening, and when and where it's happening, and how the song form, you know, being such an important and integral part of how something's perceived on the timeline of the song. How do you approach like song form as a mixer? And I wanted to touch on, just because for a lot of us, part of our curriculum deals with automation on a variety of platforms. And so I wanted to ask you, when you're dealing with song form, something that, you know, you're clearly very aware of, how do you approach automation and song form and dynamics? And how do you use automation in your mixes?
When it comes to automation, I'm old school, meaning that I don't touch automation until the very, 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 very end of the song. Because what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to make myself, I feel like sometimes automation, when you start right off the bat, you're kind of cheating in a way. At least that's the way I see it. So I want to work hard for it. So if something is not sitting right in the song, I don't want to grab that fader and automate it. No, I want to work hard. I want to carve out frequency. Why is it that it's not sitting right? So obviously there's something fundamentally wrong with the tone or the part or something. So it makes me work harder, meaning I'll try different compressors. I'll try four different EQs, different combination compressor EQ, parallel compression, an effect, maybe a widener, maybe a doubler. Whatever it is, I need to find out. I need to figure out why I want to bring that fader down. Again, the main reason why I make rides is for dynamics, not for a level in within that section. So what I try to do is I try to study the song, first of all, and by doing that, I don't want to do the, earlier in the process, why do I think that guitar should be down in the verse if I don't know the song? I don't know. Another thing I always do is I always think of the next section. If I'm in the verse, I'm thinking chorus. If I'm in the chorus, I'm thinking second verse. Subconsciously, because I want, again, that emotional shift. Sometimes there's great producers that give us that, and you don't have to touch a thing, which is great sometimes. Other times, the producer may be a great producer, but had an off day, or the artist wanted it this way, and I'm the guy that sort of the third vote that outvotes, the others. So you have to be aware of, I have to be aware of everything that's going in the song. So I choose to do automation at the very end. Now that I've established the song, the core essence of that song, whether it's a pop song or not, now I feel like, okay, well, now to build dynamics, I'm going to maybe do a ride on the guitar in the verse, maybe filter, EQ, whatever it is that I'm trying to create. Then I start jumping into rides. Automation is good, but I feel like a lot of people overuse it. Sometimes I get sessions from younger producers, and there's like, you see the little fader doing all this. And what I'll do is I'll grab the whole thing and hit delete. And it sounds better, So so try this approach and less is more. Feel the song. If it needs automation, automate it, but don't, it shouldn't be one of the first things you do. Again, I'm a song guy. A song is a song is a song, and I'm studying the song to see how we can exploit every emotion out of that song. And you won't know until, now if you wrote the song and you do all those rides, that may be a little different. But for me, as a mixer, getting the song, I don't know what's happening in the track. So, and that's why I choose to leave automation until I'm 80% done with the mix. Sometimes you find myself not using almost any automation. And it's all EQing techniques and level techniques. The art of balancing a mix. I do this thing in the south of France called Mix with the Masters. Have you guys heard of it, anybody? So what it is, it's like a week-long seminar, and we go and hang out, and I think they pick like 15 participants, and we hang out for 7 days. All we do is geek out for 8 hours a day, right? And one of the things I do there is I'll give the 15 guys 15 minutes, and we time it. Balancing a mix in 15 minutes. That means if it's a 3-minute song, you really only have 4 passes, right? And you'd be surprised, because a lot of the students nowadays are geeking out on equipment and plugins and hardware. But I say, forget all of that. Just appreciate a well-balanced mix. And I tell you, by the end of the seminar, people are like, fuck, I can't believe how much you can do by simple balancing. I feel like they get more out of that 15-minute exercise than anything else, because it just clicks. Something just clicks. Oh, I'm overdoing. We're overdoing a lot of things. We're over-processing, they're like, what did you use on the vocal on this song? Nothing. What do you mean? It sounds so good. Well, I EQ'd around it, but no, it was so over-processed that anything I did would make it sound worse, so I went the other way. I left it alone because it's the shittiest sounding vocal sound, and I EQ'd around it to make that sound natural as it came to me. Like, whoa, the whole world just opens up, So it's sometimes it's what you don't do to something. And automation, I feel the same way. Don't do automation at the beginning of a mix if you haven't heard a song. Wait till later. I hope that helped. I mean, I hope that answered the question. You guys are falling asleep, man. Really? Like, are you guys up? Let's come on. Yeah, who's up? Who's with me? Come on. Who slept less than 3 hours last night and got on the floor? Oh, all right, okay.
Now, speaking with all the different techniques that you're using in mixing and just really listening to the song and not trying to overdo it, you know, I think that a lot of people try to really hear the changes that they're making and instead of kind of holistically looking at it. Something that I wanted to ask is just being so experienced as a mix engineer, are there any problems that you commonly encounter? I know that for students, including myself, I would consistently, just be mixing a wide variety of material that's just available at the schools, like multi-tracks to practice on. And I was just wondering, for different problems that you commonly encounter, are there any like tricks or solutions that you've kind of worked out over the years? And any kind of suggestions other than what you've already been speaking about?
I'm not gonna give my secrets away.
No, of course.
Like, are you kidding? No, I don't believe in secrets. I don't believe in, we all have the same equipment, the same plugins and everything. Trial and error. I walked into one of the classes and they were showing you guys ratio and attack and release on the compressor. And I'm like, wow, that's like, the attack and release on the compressor are probably more important than anything else. That will color more on the compressor than any other knob on there or button or slider or whatever. But play around with it. Oh, this is what an attack does on the kick. Oh, shit, okay. Oh, I remember that Kanye West song kind of had that. Oh, okay, boom, store it. Oh, the release on the vocal. Oh, I get it, store it. Oh, this is what they mean by stereo bus compression when you have a high ratio and a slow attack and slow release. Sounds like Aerosmith 1979 or whatever. Boom, you store that. So that's how I do it. Just by, again, is what I said earlier. Like, oh, that's how you get that bass tone. And it's just a matter of you storing it on that drive. And then next thing you know, you get a song like, I remember when I first heard Beautiful People by Marilyn Manson, I thought it was one of the most amazing things I had ever heard at the time. And then we just did this song called Black Skinhead by Kanye, and it reminded me of that. And I'm like, funny thing is when I mixed that song, I kept thinking of Marilyn Manson, and did it help me? Maybe, but it put me in that headspace. That's worth it. It could have made the difference of me not performing right. So trial and error. You just gotta get in there, roll up the sleeves, and get your hands dirty, and just fuck things up, And don't be afraid of those overload lights. They should be white, because people are so, oh my God, you can't hit the red. No. Like, what are you talking about? Yes. Red, more red. Don't be afraid. These are tools. This is equipment. Equipment doesn't run what we do. We run it, right? So don't let the equipment dictate how you're going to perform. So that's a tool. It's great tools. But, you got to take it by its,
Yeah, practice and building a vocabulary is nice and all, but I mean, you could know the whole dictionary and still be a bad speaker,
Wait, you're saying it?
You can know the whole dictionary and be a bad speaker, it's just building that vocabulary and having that experience or that, different things that you've worked on in the past to recall and kind of put you in a mindset. I definitely agree with that perspective. Yeah. Speaking of mixing and all the different material and kind of recalling certain points of reference for the new material that's in front of you, how much would you say experimentation versus using tried and true methods comes into play? I mean, just being in demand and on those hour blocks of constant
how
work.
Well, I get the foundation of the track and the song. That comes first. If I feel like, I always say, what's the Tabasco in the song, I find what the Tabasco is. It could be a snare drum. It could be a snare drum delay. It could be 100 different things. Now, it's up to you as a tastemaker to find that Tabasco. Once I find that, then I start experimenting with that. So automatically I don't have a song and I'm like, ooh, these live strings recorded at Abbey Road, I'm gonna put a flanger through them. Why would I do that? That's a waste of time, my time, their time. No, it's fucking beautiful. Unless the producer tells me to fuck them up, I'm not gonna do anything with it. They sound incredible. So if I feel like the Tabasco is in this section, those strings, and I want them to have a different texture, I want them to have a different color because of dynamics, what's coming after it, what came before. Then I may put a little phaser on it to kind of give it that ear candy. Subconsciously, people will be like, oh, this is kind of, I love that sound. And, you know, they don't even know what it is, but it's that emotional thing that it changes enough that keeps your, that push and pull, that interaction between what you want the listener to focus on. Again, we're mind fucking. I want them to focus on this for a minute. Why? Because you don't know what I got behind that section that's gonna really slap you. So it's like sometimes it's turning something down so that they're like, oh, what's happening? And boom, the vamp hits you. It's a dynamics. Now as a listener, you're engaged. Your mind doesn't like, oh, let me check my Twitter. You know, like your mind is still engaged. And when you have a good song, a great production, and a great mix, then beautiful babies are made. You know? Yeah. Thank you for the person that started clapping and everyone followed. Thanks. Am I boring you guys? Are you guys?
Oh, okay. They're just intently listening, you know? Now, to go a little bit more logistically on receiving sessions and just working with a variety of material to mix, I wanted to ask, how do you normally receive sessions? I mean, now that we're in this digital world, is it a cloud drive based for you? Is it a delivery, like a physical delivery format, or a combination of those things?
Okay, the art of delivering files, by the way. This is something you guys should learn because a lot of you may be delivering files at one point. It's like the Wild West. I actually have two assistants, and some of them can take up to half a day just getting a session ready to be mixed. Let's go back. The way we get them is, you know, I would say 80% would be through you send it or my FTP side. It's an upload. The other 20 is the physical. You know, here's the drive with the files. But what's most important is how we get the files. So for you guys, make sure you organize stuff. You name tracks. All that stuff that seems like not necessary at the time because you're moving so fast, go back and spend the 15 minutes. Because someone like me will be like, who the fuck sent this? John Doe. Oh man, tell John Doe to fucking get his act together. Or, wow, this is so organized. Who sent this? John Doe. Who's John Doe? Now, I have an interest because I want that guy on my team. You know, I'm like, shit, So it's a good quality. So organize your tracks. Color code them if you can. Be super, super, super anal organizing tracks. And that's only going to help you because, honestly, what we have to do, we have to be super anal. Right, Terry? Yeah, yeah. See, my wife knows we're pretty anal guys, so get used to that because you have to be super anal. So when you're preparing files.
Definitely, file management is crucial. I mean, I think it's one of the most important things. Now, speaking on just file management, keeping sessions organized and different ways that you receive material, what are things that you like to see in a session? Like when you receive a session, what are things that stand out to you, good and bad? You know, like things that just kind of catch your eye right away.
Like I said, you know, just that's organized and makes our life so much simpler. Just cleaning up little things like pops, that glitches that don't need to be there. Just cleaning up sessions is just really important. Because then I don't have to worry about that stuff. I can just focus on mixing. You know, I honestly just want to throw faders up and be as creative as possible. If it takes away from the creative side, then it should have been dealt with before I got to it, I feel. And again, if you're an assistant engineer, you make the engineer's life just great. you know, that's your job. It doesn't matter how, if with organizing tracks, getting him coffee, it doesn't matter. Make him feel comfortable, because he's gonna keep you around. If he feels like you got his back, he'll have your back. And it helps, all these things that we're talking about, file management, attitude, you know, just personality, humbleness, all that stuff helps. It all helps, so.
Great. So to zoom out a little bit, you know, now that we've been diving in specifically as what you do as a mix engineer, I kind of wanted to just you know, zoom out and reflect a little bit. And I wanted to ask, for you especially, just being in your position, you would most definitely know this, what are some of the things that you feel it truly takes to become a great mix engineer in this industry?
I missed the last part.
Oh, I just wanted to ask him, like, what are some of the things that you truly feel it takes to be a great mix engineer in this industry? Just like maybe in summary, some key
besides
things.
Good looks. You got, again, it's gonna be the same thing I said: passion, great personality, just wanting to be there, good work ethic. You know, all the things that everyone's told you your whole life. It's true. When your parents say, hey, you know, do this, well, they were probably right, you know. And but again, let me go back to the passion part where I said earlier that schools don't teach that, you know. I mean, seriously, how do you learn that? I don't know how to teach it, but figure that out. You know, maybe Google it or something. Mr. Google, I'm sure, knows. So, yeah, so you gotta have all those things. You know, you gotta have all. And that's what makes it, you know, makes our life simpler.
For the individuals out here who are all really starting out and getting ready to embark on you know, their pursuing of maybe an entry position or just to get out there in the industry, what are some of the steps you think individuals starting out should take to find success? What steps did you take to get to where you are? I mean, I know we've been speaking about that for, you know, this past hour here, but what are some of the steps that you really think that people starting out should take to find success?
You know, to take the initiative to reach to guys out, like, you know, that you look up to. I mean, by a show of hands, who wants to be a producer here? Who's a producer? I just want to get to know the room, okay. Engineer, mixer, mastering engineer. Okay, there you go, all the hands go down the mastering. you know, get out there. I mean, do you guys know who mix your favorite records? I mean, do you guys read credits? I mean, it's so hard nowadays to read credits, right? Because there's really no, I mean, somebody should come up with that genius website where you type in something and it gives you a credit, right? You would think they'd have it by now. Look out who your favorite engineers and mixers are, and man, social media, reach out to them, you know? I mean, I get a ton of emails. I may not get back to them right away, but I try to get back, you know, or if I can't answer, my assistants will. And you know, and just get out there. You gotta start engaging with people that you look up to and asking them questions. And nowadays there's so much information that's out there. I mean, you guys watch the Pensados plays, or, yes, maybe, no? Okay, well, shows like that, they share a lot of information. You know, they have a lot of information that you can, you know, once you have all that, then you make the plunge. Then you start reaching out to, if you want to be an a runner to be an assistant engineer, look at all the studios, you know. Reach out to the studios, reach out to individuals, reach out to independent studios, independent labels. See who needs help, you know. See who needs maybe an intern, maybe some cool guy that gets you you get their coffee or whatever. You never know who you're gonna meet and what they're gonna, how they're gonna be able to help you help them and vice versa. So I think this is a cool industry and that we're pretty open to that, but you gotta have the right attitude. You know, that's it again. So my advice is do your homework. If you guys are dedicating the time to come here and the money that to come to a place like that, I think you guys are pretty serious about this. So you gotta, you know, I'm the kind of guy where if I'm going into something, I'm gonna be very detail oriented and try to educate myself before I go into battle, you know? So this is it, man. This is school time where you gotta do your homework. You know, I'm sure
you know, the staff here has information on all the studios, get that information and go online and search for guys, you know, other mixers, engineers, studios not only in LA or New York. Man, there's music everywhere, you know, there's a studio somewhere. Yeah, I'm not gonna say it's an easy gig. I'm not gonna say you're gonna get out of here and find a job, but you have to work at it and you have to start thinking about it now. The time is now.
Now, before we go ahead and open this up to the audience to ask questions to you, I'm curious. Now, the last question that I wanted to ask you here before we get this section going is, what were some of the mistakes that you made that you learned from the most? I mean, having such a long and successful career, I wanted to ask you that before we go ahead and conclude this section here.
Man, there's always mistakes. I mean, the time I accidentally erased the lead vocal and the girl got really mad at me. We're all gonna screw up at one. There's always mistakes, man. Sometimes you feel like you follow your gut and it's not right. But I'm okay with mistakes. You know, I honestly feel like you got to learn from them. And the mistakes are gonna make you who you are. You know, it can't all be perfect. You know, you gotta have the good and the bad. You can't have the Lakers, you know, win championships without losing those. You know, you gotta have those moments of heartache to enjoy the championships. Any Laker fans in here?
Yeah.
Yeah. Lots of booze out there. Come on. I'm not answering that guy over there. Where is he? If you have any questions, tough.
Well, Manny, again, thank you so much.
Of course, thank you. This guy, man, come on, seriously.
Thank you.
Alrighty. I see a future here.
Oh, I hope so.